Hello, this is Kevin Bacon again. A how-to video today. It's been a while, but I ran into a situation and I thought, I have a solution to this situation and maybe somebody else out there would like to have it also. Okay, there's a product that I use frequently as an adhesive. It's phenomenal stuff. There's two or three brands that are a very, very similar product. This one happens to be made by Goop. If you look at the bottom, you'll see it says Goop Automotive Contact Sealer and Adhesive. You can also use a product by, I think it's Kiwi, it's called Shoe Goo for repairing your tennis shoes. And there's another one out there, something 6000. And they're very similar. They're kind of a clear rubber adhesive. You see that it's clear. It is not an RTV. RTV stands for room temperature vulcanizing. It is not an RTV. It's not a silicone type product. It may or may not stand being around strong chemicals like carburetor cleaner or gasoline for a long period of time, but works phenomenally well in bonding leather products together. It's extremely waterproof. It's very tough when it's done. It sets up firmly but not hard. So I use it for all kinds of stuff. I can repair or bond a leather sheath together with it before I stitch it, and that gives it that extra little bit of grab. But today, and it also bonds dissimilar materials very, very well. On the back of my motorcycle, if you've seen my motorcycle video, you'll see there's a bunch of plastic animals, toys, and other sundry things glued to the box and to the front fender and all kinds of things. They're all glued on with either this or Shoe Goo, and it sets up relatively quickly. Once it's set up, it's pretty permanent. You can fight and you can pull it apart, or you can take a knife and you can slice it apart, but it's not just going to fall apart. So I like it. And the other thing that's really good about it is it'll bond rubber. And almost nothing really does a good job bonding rubber, which brings us to the topic of today. Okay, you bought yourself that really nice pistol, and you've had this pistol for a while, and you decided, man, those grips just don't fit me right. Okay, now, in case of this big old new Army, there's probably not a whole lot I'm going to do about that. I could machine the wood or whatever. There's not much room here for a finger. We could put more modern grips on it, but then it would lose its aesthetic appeal. So you're probably not going to use this on this particular one. Although I have a Plinkerton that I may re-grip, just simply because the plastic grips that came with it don't fit my hand very well. But let's say it's a service revolver. And service revolvers have an unbelievable amount of aftermarket rubber grips that you can buy to put on it. The ones that'll make it look like a Colt Diamondback or a Dan Wesson or whatever. And there's a company named Pockmar that has made a bunch of different grips that fit a bunch of them. A very, very reputable company. I really like them. In fact, my first Security 6 had Pockmar grips, and my second one did. My third one had the standard service grips on it, and my fourth one has Pockmar grips on it again. But as good a grip as they are, over a period of time, you're going to notice maybe your fingers just don't like them as much as you like. So let's take a look. Okay, Pockmar grips. 6-inch security 6. No, it's not loaded, but if it was loaded, that's my business. Okay? 6-inch security 6. Along the back strap here, there has always been a parting line where the glue, where the two halves of the mold came together to make the grips. Always been there. And, you know, it just doesn't have that finished feel to it. Along the bottom, you can see the same parting line. Although your hand doesn't go there, it's just not that final finish. And then along the fingers here, and wow, that lighting really showed it up. After a while, it became uneven. The one side kind of squished over the other side. It kind of just shifted that little bit so that now it kind of sticks out a little bit. Okay, now, first thing we can do is we can take some sandpaper and we can polish off those sharp spots and make a huge difference. I'm going to use a rotary grinding tool to do that. But where it kind of overlaps, if that isn't secured together, then it might change and overlap the other direction, and pretty soon you're just working yourself and grinding yourself back and back and back until you've ruined the grips. So we don't want to do that. So what I did first, there's one screw that holds this grip on. It's right there. You take the screw out, and then the grip is like a clamshell. It just pries apart, comes off the frame. Well, I put it on there, and then I used this sealant where it came together. I squished a pretty liberal amount inside of there because I know at some point if I need to take it apart, I can use, say, a butter knife, something of a screwdriver, something that's not horribly sharp, and I can work my way in there and I can force it back apart again. But when this cures, there's not going to be any shimmy shuffle anymore in this grip. So after curing overnight, I can now set up my little grinder and polish off the little high spots. Okay, let's do that. Okay, a couple simple cautions. Shouldn't have to tell you. Well, anyway, you know, read the instructions of your tools. Follow the instructions, or disregard the instructions, but you know, that's your business. Okay? I'm using an off-brand. This is Black & Decker. It's not the big name brand. Works fine. It was a present. I like it. I have put on it a relatively coarse sanding wheel. It's probably 60 grit. They don't tell you, but I think it's about 60 grit. It's on a rubber drum. You tighten a little screw up and it expands and holds it in place. I'm going to run it at a very low speed. The rubber that these grips is made out of is likely similar to what a tire is made out of, so it probably contains latex. If you have a problem with latex, make sure that you have some kind of a mask. You might want to. Anyway, right now I have a lot of ventilation going and moving things away. I'm going to be working left to right, so there's not much chance for a piece of this to come in my eye, but wear safety glasses if you are so predisposed. This is not loud enough for me to be concerned about hearing protection. If I was going to do it on a higher speed, then I would wear earmuffs. Okay, that takes care of safety sound. Okay, on she goes. As you can see, it's not very loud. And one thing about working at a slow speed like this, I don't have to worry about taking off way too much at a time. Now you can tell when the mold mark is gone because all of a sudden your grinding area will widen out. And you don't want to go too fast. You want to check it against your hand every now and again to make sure when you reach that point, stop. Just make it comfortable. Don't overgrind. We'll work on the bottom now. While I'm doing this, I want to tell you, I watched a rather interesting video this morning. It was a recommended video, had very few views, only just a few subscribers to the little channel. I'll hunt it up for you if you want it. Where a young boy who looked to be, I don't know, 8, 9, 10, something or other like that, was firing a Cricket 22 rifle with his parent or adult supervision, doing a very, very good job. And what interested me the most were all the liberal do-gooders out there talking about how this guy was going to end up being a serial killer. That's how serial killers are started. And I'm going to tell you, I was shooting at a very young age. If we didn't have something, we made something. And I have not, to my knowledge, turned out to be a serial killer. I don't seem to have more than one personality or any of that kind of stuff. So I really have to believe that the nonsense that some of these people spew has got to come from just too many years of reading drivel. Hey, now in that short little period of time, you can made a tremendous difference in the heel of that. So if your hand is now on the heel, you don't feel that sharp little edge. I'm going to go ahead now and finish these off camera, because I think you've seen what goes on and gotten the idea. But very simple. If you didn't have one of these rotary tools, it would be just as easy to use a file, a coarse file, a very fine file, probably a long, long time ahead, or some handheld sandpaper. Wrap it around a pencil or a stick or a dowel rod, your finger, and get in there and just kind of polish that up. Now I'm going to buff this off a little bit more and I'll show you the final result. And there we go. Nice and smooth on the bottom. Nice and smooth now across the finger grips. And although there's a little contrast there, the difference in the grip is unbelievable. From tolerable to very, very comfortable. And that's really where you need to be, especially if you're going to spend any time at the range firing these things, or if you had to carry it for a period of time in your hand. For example, I have property here I could hunt on. If I were out hunting with the pistol, there would maybe be a fair amount of time when the pistol be out of its holster in my hand, just simply to be quicker and quieter in pursuing game. Same thing would go if you were on security detail of any kind and felt the need to have your revolver in your hand. It's much better if it's a comfortable grip. Now, I have semi-automatics and I have revolvers. I am a revolver freak. I like my semis, but I really like my revolvers. I'm an old school kind of guy. You can't hardly jam a revolver, and that makes a big difference. And the other thing is, I have those two stages of operation where I can either have the hammer back for double action or for single action, or I can just pull the trigger for double action. And it allows for a little bit difference. Not to mention, this being 357, I can fire the 357s for, say, deer or larger game, or I can shoot 38 specials if I don't want to ruin my hearing. Okay, that's it for today. Well, not necessarily for today, but that's it for this video. Kevin Bacon. Bye. I hope that helped.